extent of the extensions marked out on the ground, which was most useful. You may recall that when we went round the rear of the property looking down the garden, I asked for the position of the rear boundary fence to be pointed out. It's a bit difficult to see against the light, but there was a wire mesh fence which would go diagonally across the rear of the house, the rear of the garden. I don't think anyone is against reasonable improvement and extension of this property, but it needs to be done in the context of the CALDY conservation area. As I see it, there are three issues, directly or indirectly affecting this. The size of the plot, the size of the extension relative to the original house, and the proximity of the extension to the adjacent house, number 47. And as it's been said, there have been no objections to number 47, but number 47 itself is currently undergoing a considerable programme of rebuilding. I think we were told on the site visit the actual distance of the westerly extension of number 45 towards the boundary of number 47 was only 1.7 metres. Now, the proposed extension virtually doubles the size of the existing house, so it is substantial. And the because of the shape of the boundary, it actually comes behind part of the plot of the adjacent house number 47. The other thing you need to be aware of is that number 47 itself was an original house on this plot in a large, much larger area of land. Not only 47 as shown, but number 45, this application property, and the piece of land down to the bottom left. So that was the whole plot of number 47. And at some time in, I think, the 1960s, it was divided off into two pieces by number 45 to be built. Now this is within the zone one of the CALDY conservation area, where the assumption is no more than 2.5 dwellings per hectare. With the piece at the bottom left included with the plot of number 45, and by taking the boundary in the strange way they did around the garret back of the garden of 47, they were able to achieve sufficient ground to build a second dwelling in the original plot. Now, as you see, the boundary is much reduced. So now we're talking about a house which probably shouldn't have been built in that plot in the first place, and we're looking to double its size with an extension, which goes right up to what I can only describe as a most unsuitable boundary. But that is what you're looking at now. The CALDY conservation area management plan does, in terms of, calls for a special planning note to incorporate the essence of the covenant requirements of the original estate. And that, I think, is what it results in SPGA, the maximum 2.5 dwellings per hectare. In terms of new buildings, and of course this is now not an individual new building, in terms of scale, massing, position, or proportion of new buildings should respect the footprint sizes of existing neighbouring buildings and their relationships with each other, spacing, the road, and their site boundaries. And then, in terms of extensions to dwellings, which are also, as is noted in your report, covered by policy HS 11 of the UDP, the following are additional matters which have been identified as particular issues in the CALDY conservation area. Extensions to buildings within the conservation area may detract from the significance of the individual building or the setting of adjoining buildings. Sufficient space should remain between lateral extensions and boundaries to retain the detached characteristics of the properties. On the original estate, the provisions of the covenant should be observed. Now, they're not calling you to get involved in covenants, it's just saying that the plans should now take account of the provisions of the covenants, of the original covenants. Just as an aside, over the page, it says dormers, if acceptable, should be confined to rear elevations. I think we've got dormers on the front of this one. So, all in all, I can quite understand why the CALDY Society, who are supposedly the committee looking to preserve the conservation area, slightly better. And on that basis, I did thought we'd be taking out a delegation by reason of its size and scale, representing an overdevelopment of the site, unacceptably close to a neighbouring property, and contrary to HS11, CH2, CH11, and various items, as I've read out to you in the CALDY Conservation Area Appraisal and Management Plan. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you,
Geoffrey.
Clare, Consulting Committee.
Thank you, Chair. It was a very enjoyable site visit. Very interested in the CALDY Conservation Area, what goes on there, what does happen, what doesn't happen, because we've worked very hard with the CALDY Conservation programme to make sure that this sort of area is kept up to good standard. Just to remind the councillor that the conservation point three on in relation to boundaries stipulates strong, is it? Yeah. Preserve the unity of strong enclosed border boundary treatments incorporating high walls, dense landscape, or dark stained close border timber fences in the area outside the village core itself. Given the view that the development is quite close to the neighbouring property, the extension, taking that point that I've just read out, I can't see any problem with overlooking being so close to the boundary. I thought it was nice, actually a very interesting alteration to the building that's there. On one, I have no problem in supporting it.
Chair. Thanks, Chair. While I understand, you know, Councillor Watt is representing his constituents, you know, we did on the site visit, it does look like it's going to be a really extremely well thought out project, and there is sufficient space between the proposed building and number 47. And the fact that 47 has raised no objection to this proposed application, I will not be refusing this application today.
David? Yeah, thank you, Chair. Well, as somebody who went on the site visit, my first impression was that the house should be a lot further over to the right, but it's on that piece of paper. It seemed to be badly located on the site, allowing for the extension that's been added. Originally, before the swimming pool was there, you will see the house was roughly in the middle of the plot. Now, having decided to get rid of the swimming pool on the left-hand side as you look at it, and then turn that into quite a large development, it shifted the whole centre of the property way over to the left. And because it is only 1.7 metres from the fence line, and it is incredibly close, effectively, to number 47, I think that actually is a problem. I'd like Matthew, if you will, please, to just put up the drawing of the elevations for this particular development so that the rest of the committee can see what we saw on the site visit. I'm not sure whether there's a reason here for turning it down, but I think we ought to appreciate what is being imposed on number 47, albeit they have not objected to it. Having said that, 38, I have no idea whatsoever why they're objecting it. It has no visual impact on them in any way, shape or form. So I don't accept the reasons for rejecting it. I mean, to say that it will reduce privacy, to whom? Scale of the extension, that's the thing that we may be concerned about. Proximity to number 47, fine, but why is 38 complaining about the access and proximity to number 47? That's up to them to have a look at. Anyway, having looked at what we've got here, that is what is proposed. We saw the house at the top part there, the left-hand part of that development was as we saw it. The right-hand three bays, including the right three door windows, are what is now being proposed. And it's quite a healthy and large extension. The bit that's on the left is a irrelevant because it goes further into the site and in fact balances the site from the point of view of getting it into the centre. The one that concerns me greatly is the bottom left elevation, which is the one that would be looking against, or would be against, the rear garden of number 47. Now that looks like, okay, there's no overlooking, but it's a rather horrible, if I may say so, blank wall. I wouldn't cat to be next door to me if I lived at number 47. Having said that, there is landscaping between the two houses. One assumed the landscaping would be there is a condition again saying that landscaping treatment will be required. But I'm just uneasy over that particular elevation being directed from nowhere, if you like, because there's no sign of anything from the side of 47 looking towards 45 at the moment. And there's suddenly going to be a large wall erected right within 1.7 metres of the boundary line. Now, I thought that was a little bit over-dominant, a little unacceptably close, and a bit out of character with the area. But I don't know what other people think about this. Having said that, I'm not sure that we have a sufficient reason to refuse it. But I'd like other people to comment on what I've said, because I do believe, that's my first impression seeing it, that that wall on the left-hand side was a bit sort of, you know, a bit like being next door to Walton Journal. Don't like it.
Thanks, David. I'm just going to ask Matthew to explain the elevations.
Thank you to you, Chair. Just so that members can understand, what's there at the moment is this part of the site. This front little rocket shape, if you like, that's a new extension to the front of the building, and then this single storey extension to the side. But as you stand on CROFT DRIVE EAST, and for those members who are at the site visit, this part of the house is already there, but there's already a substantial wall that runs along the front of that site, and then beyond that is the open pool at the back. So when you understand the relationship of that, standing in CROFT DRIVE EAST, you would see this part of that anyway, because that wall is already there. So in terms of what you would see if this application was approved, it is essentially this roof space and the three dorms. That's looking at it from CROFT DRIVE EAST. Just to come back to the point that Councillor Elderton raises about the potential over-dominant effect of this side gable on 47 CROFT DRIVE EAST. The ridge height of this is lower than that, that's already there. But if I just go back to this plan, I can't say that we would be able to sustain the reason for overdominance, because there is a substantial rear garden to number 47. And you're only talking about this part of that garden. So I'm not sure that that could be sustained, but it's down to committee to make that decision.
Thank you, Mr. Matthew. Are you okay with that, David?
Yes, thank you.
Yes, Steve?
Yeah, David asked for comments, and there was a comment made by the ward councillor about the size and mass of that building. By my ready reckoning, I've done a little sort of measurement. It's certainly the same size, if not smaller, than number 46. Certainly smaller than number 38. It's almost identical match to number 41 in terms of size. I think you may have a mild point on the location within that site, and the size of the plot is fairly compatible with the others. If there's any overlooking going on, that's actually from 47 over to 45, because the back of that property has first floor balconies. So it's the other way around, actually.
I'm saying the overlooking or over dominance.
So my view is that, you know, it might be a case of keeping up with the Joneses, who can have the biggest house around there, I don't know. But it's certainly a pleasant plot, and if that's the desire of the owner to extend to that extent, who are we to stand in the way? So my view is I would be sympathetic to the application.
Thank you, Chair. I usually have a huge amount of sympathy for conservation areas, and CALDY is no different. I just want to speak briefly in defence of residents in number 38, actually. I could well understand why they put forward objections in defending the principles of CALDY conservation area, even if it's directly affected. It may do in the future, in principle. Having said that, I actually see no problem with this particular application.
Thank you, Wendy.
Mentioned something about dormer windows at the front of properties in the conservation area, and I do know that conservation areas need to
attractive in terms of other properties that are located within the Calder conservation area. So it is identified as neutral, possibly a little worse than neutral. We've taken account of the impact that the improvements and the remodelling would have, and we consider that even with the dormers, it would improve the appearance of this part of the conservation area.
Just to add a couple of thoughts, given that I was on the site visit as well, I mean, my concern was what David raised. You know, you look at that site elevation, it's pretty ugly, I think. That's what it is, it's ugly, I think. And I think given the parameters we operate under, we would really struggle, I think, in terms of refusing this. So I accept the point, but having been there, I'd be minded to vote in favour.
Are you moving that part?
I wasn't
particularly
moving that.
Did you want to say something else, Dave?
Just picking up David's point earlier on about the neighbour and close proximity to the neighbour. Seven of the neighbours were notified on only one objective, and that was the person across the road within the 30 acres. So the person who was next door, either side, got no objection to this particular application taking place. And I should take the one to the rear. Very small property at the bottom of the lane.
I'm going to move on this now.
I'll move the recommendation.
So you'll move the recommendation? Right, thank you very much.
And I'm seconded.
Thank you, Jeff. Right, the officer's recommendation is to approve subject to the conditions listed. All those in favour? That's unanimous, that's correct. Oh, sorry, I apologise. And David, you're voting in?
Yes.
Okay, that's carried. We can now move to agenda item 10, Land East of Tarran Way, West of MORETON, pages 87 to 92. Mark, you could have a presentation, please.
Thank you, through you, Chair, very quickly. Planning permission is sought for a replacement wastewater pumping station compound, control kiosk, and new access. Permission was first granted for this proposal in 2013, and the current proposals seek consent for as-built modifications to the original design. The works are nearing completion following the 2013 consent, and the changes now applied are very minor, which include a reduced footprint and changes to the surfacing of the turning area for vehicles. Proposals form part of the wider improvements to water quality in the Lisa area. Proposals are recommended for approval and there have been no representations made in the application.
I'll
second
that,
Chair.
I'm just checking that there's no one councillors. Okay, so we've got move on, we've got a second up. All those in favour of approval? Now move to agenda item 11, which is all the supermarket 9 Main Road, Heswell, pages 92 to 98.
Thank you, Chair. Planning permission is sought for the refurbishment works to the existing Aldi supermarket in Heswell. The store itself remains the same footprint, so there is no additional floor space proposed. The changes involve a replacement of plant equipment, such as refrigeration units, which will result in quieter units being installed, changes to the external cladding and roof covering, new frontage at the store's entrance, renewal of the trolley bay canopy, rendering to the loading bay walls, and alteration to car park layout. Presently, 124 car parking spaces are on site, but by reconfiguring the central parking area and the addition of extra mother and baby spaces outside the store itself, the number of spaces will increase by 13 to provide a total of 137 spaces. There will be no increase in the number of spaces along the Darrell Road boundary of the site at the rear, with the current 44 spaces remaining, and similarly, the 6 spaces adjacent to 8 Darrell Road will not increase. Therefore, there will be no additional vehicle movements at these parts of the site. The changes to the store itself are principally cosmetic improvements and upgrading of materials and cladding. Hours of operation and deliveries remain as previously conditioned, and the new plant equipment proposed will result in lower noise. proposals are considered acceptable and are recommended for approval. There's no petition in connection with this application.
Thank you.
We don't
have
a more
David?
On the ground that these are improvements on existing facility, I would like to approve it.
Thank you, David. Do
you
have a second
that?
Councillor Leary, all those in favour, subject to the petition, requested. Against? Okay, that's fine, thank you. We can now move to agenda item 12, which is another old supermarket application for 9 May Road, Keswick. Matthew, can you take it, please?
Thank you, to you, Chair. This is the same site as the one you've just previously determined, except this application deals with advertisement consent. It's for adverts at the Arran supermarket and additional adverts at the store entrance in the shape of two new poster boards. These would be internally illuminated and would face the car park, therefore there would be no impact on residential properties. The one of the new signs at the vehicular entrance to the site would be located 46 metres away from the nearest residential property and would be seen within the context of the existing street furniture and lighting. Therefore, again, there would be no impact on neighbours and amenity. The remainder of the adverts sought relate to the replacement and upgrading of existing signage. The proposals are considered to be acceptable and are recommended for approval. Again, there's no petition in relation to this application.
David?
Yes,
approved. Thank you. Denise, seconded. Thank you. All those in favour of approval? That's unanimous. That's carried. Thank you. Can we now move to agenda item 13, which is 34, removal of post 7, pages 105 to 110. Matthew, can I have the presentation, please?
Thank you, through you, Chair. Planning permission is sought for the erection of a two-storey side extension and single-storey rear and side extensions to this detached property located at the head of the cul-de-sac at Greenville Close. The existing side garden measures 17 metres wide from the gable end of the original property to the boundary of Green Lane, so that's this distance here, that's 17 metres. If the extension is approved, a width of 12 metres would still be retained, which is still significantly larger than most side gardens in this location. The front elevations of 21 and 23 Green Lane, so that's these two properties here, they look directly over the site and are presently located 21 metres away from the gable of the application property. The gable elevation of the proposed extension will be blank, with no windows proposed on that elevation. In such instances where habitable room windows look onto blank elevations, a minimum distance of 14 metres should be achieved. In this case, a distance of 16 metres between the front elevation of 21 and 23 Green Lane would be maintained, which exceeds the minimum distance expected. The extensions at the rear are single storey and would not result in overlooking or loss of privacy. Proposals for the erection of an additional dwelling on this plot have been refused on three occasions, most recently in November 2015. A refusal back in 2008 was also subsequently dismissed at appeal. However, those proposals related to a new separate dwelling for which adequate community space could not be provided and the minimum separation distances between 21 and 23 Green Lane could not be satisfied. These proposals offer extensions and they satisfy criteria set out in policy HS 11. It would not result in an overdeveloped or cramped appearance with ample space retained to the side of the property. The proposals are recommended for approval and there is no additional objection.
Thank you, sir.
Just a
very
quick commentary. I think there was a fear that if one could try and turn this extension into another pair of semi-detached house, but that seemed to be impossible because of separation distances from 21 and 23. There isn't room to extend the house wider than 10 to the semi. But of course, if that proposal was to come forward in the future, that would have to be subject to another planning application anyway. So just wanted to raise that point, because that was the fear that people had when we looked at this at that briefing. It's a possibility, but that's dismissed now because that couldn't possibly happen.
Yeah,
no, the previous one was attacked. What I'm saying is this might have been a sneaky way of trying to end up with a pair of semis there rather than two detached houses. And that's where the problem is. That's the point I make. Just want people to understand.
Okay, anything else? No? The officer's recommendation is to approve subject to the conditions listed. All those in favour of approval? Oh, sorry, can we have a move first? Denise, seconder, Wendy, all those in favour? That's unanimous, that's carried, thank you. Agenda item 14 seeks to gain members' approval for planning applications decided on the delegated powers between the 7th of December and the 10th of January. Are we happy to approve those?
Thank you.
Thank you. Agenda item 15 is planning appeals